Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Kathy Dempsey and her business partner, Lenny. Has anyone seen Kathy or Lenny?
Lenny? Has anybody seen Lenny? Ma'am, have you seen Lenny? Cheryl?
No.
Have you seen Lenny anywhere? No. I tell you what, if I showed you a picture of him, would that help?
Yes.
Okay. Here's a picture of Lenny. And he's missing. And I think I know what happened to him. How many of you have ever heard of Patch Adams or Doc Hollywood? He's the doc who helps take care of kids. You all have him? Well, I was speaking at a healthcare conference a while back, and Patch was the luncheon keynote speaker, and I was the closing keynote speaker, and we got to meet at this really nice reception the night before. And he said, Kathy, have you taken Lenny to the doctor? It's like, no, Patch. He's a lizard. He said, well, he is your partner. You travel all over the world together. Don't you think it'd be a good idea if he found out he was healthy? I said, Patch, he's a plastic lizard. He said, Kathy, we have plastic surgeons. It's like, oh, come on. He said, I've made an appointment for tomorrow with one of the best docs in Scottsdale, Doug Lakin. He even wears lizard shirts. And so Lenny's in the middle of his physical, and the phone rings. And Lenny said, I want to pick up the phone. Dr. Lakin, excuse me. So Lenny picks up the phone. And the call said, Lenny, you and Kathy, you've got to be for Fresenius. You've got to be at their conference. You promised you would be there. And Lenny says, Fresenius? He said, I love Fresenius. He says, there's one right down the street. He said, I'll just go show up. And there he showed up right outside the Mesa Dialysis Clinic. And he said, I got to go say hi, and we're going to have a great time. And so then he was in and hanging around some of the machines and yoo-hoo. Yeah, and then they taught him how to do the water test. Wow. Woo. 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 He had that one hands down. And then he met this awesome group here of Lillian and Andrew and Chris, and they're like, hey, dude, welcome, Lenny. One problem, it's not here in Arizona. The conference is in Chicago. And Lenny's like, what? He said, okay, I'll drive to Chicago. It's like, Lenny, you can't drive your pink Barbie Jeep all the way from Arizona to Chicago. Go make it in time. Come up with a different plan. He said, okay, I'll use my frequent flyer miles. So rumor has it that he did fly into O'Hare yesterday. Now, we know this to be true because he was spotted earlier outside the registration area. And he said, well, I guess I better register for the conference. So he went up and stood in this line, and I cannot believe it. You all are such an amazing group. You gave him his own name badge. Awesome. Thank you. And then they said, well, if you really want to find everybody, you've got to find Ron, our CEO. Because if you find Ron, he's speaking before you, then you'll find everybody else. So Lenny said, oh, this is a huge convention center, but all right. So Lenny looked around, and finally, he found Ron. And rumor has it that he was playing the song Lenny, and the jet. I don't know, whatever that was. But he's obviously around here somewhere. The problem is we've got to find Lenny. So what we're going to do is, in fact, I'm going to reward somebody, all right? We'll give you a little reward here to see if you can help us out so quick, all right? So first person that finds Lenny, and he likes to hide under chairs, that's his MO, so if you even have a chair beside you that's empty, look under, we'll give you a Shed of Your Dead book. First person who can find Lenny, please help us. What? Woohoo! Awesome. What's your name?
Faye.
Oh, thank you, Faye. Here's a copy of this book. And, you know, I'm going to be a little tied up. Would you mind, Would you mind taking care of Lenny for me? And what's your name?
Ivy.
Ivy. Excellent, excellent. So let's give Ivy a hand for taking care of Lenny. Woo-hoo! Ivy, can you hold Lenny up? Can you all say good morning to Lenny? You see, you know now that Lenny travels all over the place. And he said, when you get with a group, will you share with them today my favorite story? It comes from July 29th, 1998, as I wrote in my journal that night. It was 7 o'clock in the morning, and I rushed into a quarterly ethics meeting at the hospital. I ran into one of my friends. He was one of my strange friends. Do any of you have any strange friends? Are any of you a strange friend? Okay, more hands went. Oh, we got 2 hands going up on that one. All right, all right. Well, David was a little strange because he owned a pet snake. And I said, good morning, David. How are you? And how's your snake? I'm fine, Kathy. My snake is fine, but my lizard is dead. I said, what? He said, Kathy, it didn't shed its skin. That's how lizards grow. And if they're not shedding, they're not growing, and they die. I thought, wow. I said, David, what can we learn as humans from the lizard? He said, Kathy, we as humans grow physically and mentally and spiritually, and if we don't shed, if we don't grow, we die. I said, what might our skin represent? Maybe old habits, maybe negative attitudes, maybe unhealthy relationships. Simultaneously, it was like a light bulb went off. Shed or you're dead. So, in the next few minutes, I'm going to challenge you to shed a little skin. Now, shedding's a 2-part process. First, just letting go of the old, all those things that don't serve you anymore, that may have once, but not anymore. And the second part of shedding is taking on the new skills, the knowledge, the things that you're here at the conference this week to go back and implement. So Lenny's going to be here as a reminder for us to shed. So when you see Lenny, I want you to think of the word shed, all right? And we're actually going to have a code chant, all right? So when I go like this, I'd like for you to go like this, and that's when we all say shed, okay? So let's try it. Ready? 1, 2, 3, shed, okay. Keep following me. Ready? Again? Shed, 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 shed. Woohoo! You rock, you rock, you rock. All right, that's our shed chant to remind us to shed. Welcome to the shedding revolution. The shedding revolution equips people and organizations with the skills, the motivation, and the support of accountability to embrace and celebrate change. And in the shedding revolution, you always have a choice. The mantra of the shedding revolution is learn it, share it, live it. Learn it, share it, live it. You're going to learn some things here, then we're going to ask you to go back and share them with somebody else, and then we're going to ask you to do that third step of living it. No organization can thrive unless their people can shed. So why does 75% of all change efforts fail? Because people lack the skills and the motivation and the support of accountability to be successful. I don't know if any of you read Harvard Business Review, but issue back, this was the front cover. Change faster. Any of you been asked to do that recently? Just a tad bit, yeah, yeah, yeah. And it's gonna get faster and faster and faster, especially in healthcare. So we've gotta be able to arm ourselves with the skills, motivation, and support of accountability to be super shedders. Because it's shed or you and your organization may be dead. Now, I remember I was flying through the Atlanta airport, changing planes when this was on the newsstand, and I ran up to the newsstand, I'm grabbing it off, and then I ran over to the cashier, and I said, I can't believe this, ma'am. I can't believe it. She says, what? I said, I can't believe they put Lenny's great-great-grandfather on the front cover of Harvard Business Review. What are the chances? Well, I'm going to share with you in the next few minutes three foundational R's for rapid shedding, and you can use these at work or at home. So, in just a minute, I'm going to ask you to find a partner, all right? So you may want to put your stuff down if you're holding something, drink down or whatever. There are two guidelines on this partnership. And I've already seen you. You are a live and fired up group, so I have no question of whether you can do it or not. First is, your partner, we're going to give you 10 seconds, all right? 10 seconds to find your partner and stand right beside him face to face. The second is, your partner must be at least sitting 10 feet away from where you're currently sitting. Ready? When I say ready, set, shed. 10 seconds, 10 feet, stand by your partner. Ready, set, shed! Does everybody have a partner? Okay, all right. If you have not found a partner yet, I want you to stand and I want you to be an observer, all right? All right, the first assignment in your partnership, decide which one of you wants to be the letter A and which one of you wants to be the letter D, very quickly. All right, all the A's, give me a big wahoo! Awesome. All the D's, a big wahoo! Awesome, awesome. Some of you D's have no idea why you're D, but you're a yaha! Woo! All right, so here's the situation. I need to talk to the A's first. A's, you've arrived in Chicago, in this beautiful convention center, and you're walking and walking and walking and walking and walking and walking, and finally you get to the registration desk, and you're looking down the hallway, and you say, no. It can't be. It is. It's my best friend from high school. I mean, what are the chances? You have been looking for your best friend from high school for 30 years. I mean, you've looked on class reunion and Facebook and LinkedIn, and what are the chances you're here for this conference and you found your best friend? Woohoo! Now, D's, you never really liked them. Sorry. I mean, you were so glad when high school was over and you got to shed them. So here's the deal. In just a minute, you're going to have your 30-year class reunion, all right? Now, they're coming at you. This is a professional conference, so D's, you're just going to have to deal with it, all right? So, I have some instructions I'm going to flash up on the screens for the A's. D's, I need you to turn around and face the back wall for about 10 seconds. Okay, A's, are you ready for your instructions? Here we go. All right, can you do it? Can you do it passionately? All right, ready, set, shed! Okay, A's, 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 here we go. Shed, 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 shed. Awesome, 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 awesome. Oh, A's, you did an awesome job. Yes, you deserve applause. Woo-hoo! Wow, best audience I've seen A's do it. I mean, some of you were going, glum, glum, glum. So. Now, D's, are you okay? I mean, you're feeling a little uncomfortable? A little personal space issues going on here. Now, we laugh. But how many of us know somebody that we work with who just won't let it go? I mean, they keep holding on and holding on. You're saying, shed, lady, shed. We have a tendency to over-attach. So what is something that you need to shed that you might be over-attached to? Now, we'll just hold that thought. I have an announcement for the A's. I'm sorry to tell you, but it's time to say goodbye to your partner. Great job! Woohoo! All right, D's, if you want to know what your partner was instructions, here's what their instructions were right there. Awesome job, awesome job. I bow to the A's, bow to the A's. All right. The first R of shedding is to release the attachment. Now, most of us don't remember when we're born, but guess what? You had a cord. You were majorly attached to your mom. And when you came out, somebody cut the cord, right? So I will submit that was your first major shedding experience of this lifetime. And from the time you are born until the time you die, you will continue to go through a series of attachments and detachments, attachments and detachments, attachments and detachments. Now, they're not that physical one like that cord, but they're the emotional ones. And your ability to deal with the emotional detachments is critical to your success and happiness. Now, there's three different areas that get people caught up. They kind of get over-attached to. The first is roles. We get attached to our roles. I'm a nurse. I'm a doctor. I'm a manager. I'm an executive. I'm a spouse. We get attached to our roles. Nothing wrong with them, but we need to realize all roles will end one day. What are you doing to prepare for your next role? Things. We like our things. We like our stuff, right? This is my house and my car and my office and my pen. I think that's my pen. I mean, even the littlest things, right? And beliefs. Traditions. This is the way we've always done it. Some of you really do still keep saying, I still like paper charting. You know who you are. And you never know. Because at any point in time, everything you own and everyone you love, you will lose. You will shed. Roles. I started my role as an ER trauma nurse in my mid-20s. And all of a sudden, one day, I got a phone call. Kathy. Yes. Can I take some test results? Sure. Mine? I'd just been given my death sentence, AIDS. You see, I was a nurse working in the emergency room and a trauma patient came in and cracked his chest and my hands were wrist deep inside him and I had to happen to have a cut on my finger. And as many of you know, back in the mid-80s, we didn't wear gloves. The doctors confirmed the test, and all of a sudden the CDC got involved, and I was about to become their poster child. You see, I was the first healthcare worker in the United States to be tested HIV positive from a workplace exposure. Sat down, told my boss, so sympathetic, but said, Kathy, I'm sorry, if this news gets out, this hospital will shut down. I'm sorry, but you can't work here anymore. My role was shed, just like that. I was just trying to help somebody. Well, as you imagine, I was not coping well. My friends started to alienate me. My church started to alienate me. I finally ended up in a hotel parking lot with a bottle of pills in my hand, and I was about to end it all. And someone intervened. I believe it was divine intervention, said, "Kathy Dempsey, I'm not finished with you yet." And somebody knocked on my car door window and said, "Are you okay?" And she got me through the night. And you know, you have those people in your life that are right. So 3 months later, I was sitting at home in my living room watching my new TV set, and the phone rang. It was the doctor. He said, "I don't know how to say this, Kathy, but all of your tests, all eight of your tests have come back negative." Woohoo! Wow! All those regrets I had back in the car, all those things, it was like one of those old VCRs, and I get to push replay. Here I was in my mid-20s. Yes, my job had been shed, but it set a trajectory of my life that I would not be standing in front of you today if that had not happened. So we never know about our roles and how they'll change. I never knew I would be standing on a stage sharing that story because I didn't think I was going to be alive. It was a miracle, a double miracle. First of all, that all the tests came back negative, and second, that woman found me in the car. Change is a loss of some kind. Here are the 5 stages of the shedding revolution change. When I click them, shout them out for me. The first is... Second is, third is, fourth is, and the fifth is. Now you may say I recognize some of those, but celebration? Yes, celebration is part of shedding. It is. Do you know you celebrate the most painful day of your life every single year? Some guy said to me, like you sitting up front, he said, "My anniversary." It's like, luckily his wife wasn't there. So celebration is important, and celebrating in advance is even more important. So it's not linear stages. If you think of the Shedding Revolution's 5 stages, it's kind of like an abnormal EKG. You go up and down. A baseline of acceptance is where you want to be at, and ultimately at celebration. But the others are important. Do you think I was experiencing loss when I got fired? After the HIV test? Absolutely, I love what I did. So I had to go through some of these stages, and I did not have the skills that we were talking about today to arm myself to get through. I was making a bad choice by saying I'm gonna end my life. The key is don't get stuck. And I was stuck in loss. I couldn't imagine it. Number one biggest barrier to shedding is, everybody?
Fear.
Fear. Fear. 95% of people say it's the number one thing that holds them back. You know, I had the privilege of going into Disney and speaking a while back. And do you know, after I spoke, they took me on a really cool backstage tour. And you know what I discovered? Walt Disney was afraid of mice. Really? Afraid of mice? So what did Walt do? He didn't shed his fear. He embraced his fear. He said, "Maybe I can make it more playful. I'll make a funny face and big ears, and I'll call my fear Mickey." And Walt embraced his biggest fear and turned it into his biggest professional success. And there are consequences of not embracing your fear, because I imagine if we took a poll, there probably 99% of this room had been to some kind of Disney park or adventure. And if Disney hadn't embraced it, how many memories and vacations and childhood adventures would be stripped away from you? Most people can't believe that I'm afraid of speaking, but I was. Back in the hospital, my boss would sit down every morning, 9 o'clock, Kathy, you've got to talk in meetings. There's only 5 people here. But I was afraid, and I had to embrace my fear in order to do what I've been placed on this earth to do. But what are we going to do? Because times are scary. Things are scary, especially in healthcare. We've got some bumpy waters before we get to where we're going to go in the future. The key is to take action. Take action. Because fear plus action equals courage. And it will take courageous leaders to lead us into the healthcare of the future. Second is reframe the situation. Now, some changes may seem initially overwhelmingly negative, but usually, as given enough time, most of us come around and say, you know, that was a blessing in disguise. So reframe is seeing the situation from the most positive light. So you want to be able to reframe quickly. You want to be able to hire people that can reframe quickly. If you've got some bad news to share, you want to play a reframe game. Okay, take 2 minutes and let's see who can come up with the best reframe of the situation. Now, there's a challenge that gets in the way. It's a syndrome. Above-the-neck constipation. Yeah, you know what this is. It's that stinking thinking, that negativity that can consume a work environment and situation. So Lenny has a formula. And he's got a treatment, and he says, we need a mental enema. Yes, we do. And there is a formula of 5 formulas. Today, we're going to just talk about 1, and that's shed complaining. Do you know the average person complains 15 to 30 times a day? 34 minutes on Monday. Yeah. Just think about it. Shed complaining. What would happen if we could shed complaining? So, you know, I've got a bracelet right here, and I was wondering, maybe could you read what that is, what that says? It's an eye test.
I'm allergic to negativity.
I'm allergic to negativity. Okay, all right. So I'm going to place this on, and now you have a new allergy, okay? Is it Bill or William?
William.
So now you're allergic to?
Negativity.
Negativity, exactly. So you can't handle that, all right? All right, great. So I'm coming up to you. William? Do you know they cut my budget?
They did?
Yes.
Well, how can you operate on what you have?
Exactly. What are we going to do about it? They're going to cut yours next. Come on. All right, just smile at me, fine. All right, whatever. So I'm going to say, if anybody says anything negative to you, I want you to tell them to shut up, okay? All right? Shed the negativity and keep your positive attitude up, all right? Got it? So what we're going to do is we're going to declare the rest of the day, I'm allergic to negativity, shed complaining day, all right? Keep each other accountable. So if you complain, you just snap yourself on a wrist. If you get a band, if you see somebody else complain, you're going to tell them to do what?
Shut up.
Woo! All right. Now I've got a bunch of these bands. We'll give some out later. Oops. Good thing I don't play baseball or pitching or whatever. So, there's a few. We'll give some more away in a little bit, maybe at the end or if you see me at the conference. But I tell you, these little bands have transformed organizations. One quick example, probably the best example, is the long-term healthcare of Mayo Clinic, who made these bracelets part of their uniform. So when you came to work, you had to have your name badge and your bracelet. And they caused so much commotion within the Mayo system that they sent photographers and news reporters to do a big spread in their internal newspaper because they had shut down negativity and they were positive. They wouldn't tolerate it. So we're going to give you lots of resources later on, but we can be glad to share with you the sign-up sheets and the rules and how you can have fun with I'm allergic to negativity. And the last one is refocus your energy. Manage your energy is critical in the future in 3 areas. 1, recharge management. 1, be in the now management. And 1, control management. And we've got to be able to deal with all 3 of these. How do you shed? You know, you're going to have an app later on, and you're going to have some reminders, because shedding is about reminders and resources. And one of them is going to tell you about these shed styles, and each brings a different strength to the team. And you can look at the app and see the front and back page, and it'll give you a little information about reminders. If you want to take more in the Survival Guide book, there is an actual assessment tool that you can take to tell what kind of shed style you are and how to adapt your shed style to be 75% more effective. You always have a choice. You know, I have a choice right now. First of all, I gotta get a drink of water before I say any more. I'm gonna share with you a story that I've never shared before. So there's a little fear there. It's a very personal story. But I believe that I had to shed what I was planning because I'm supposed to close with this story with you at this divine appointed day. I get asked a lot, how did you get to Arizona? Well, I was traveling all over the world. I was speaking in Scottsdale, Arizona, got sick, got sent to somebody's friend's doctor who grounded me, said cancel all your speaking engagements, cancel all your flights for the next 3 weeks, you're grounded. So I never left. I live in Scottsdale, Arizona. And it wasn't but a few days that I met this amazing man. His name is Ron Black. Now, Ron was a music man. He loved it. He lit up. Every cell of his body lit up when he was playing music, or he was teaching somebody else, adult or a child, how to play guitar. And Ron and I had wonderful times together. We played together. We rode bikes together. We just had a great time together. But I was a little guarded, you know. You know, you've had those situations in life, maybe that you've been hurt before, and, you know, you're just taking it slow. So, you know, Ron and I dated, and we always dreamed that we would go to Hawaii for a few weeks in the summer. So 4 years later, the decision's made. The opportunity's there. We're going to go to Hawaii. So we booked our ticket. We booked our condo. We booked our celebratory. Finally, our dream has come true. And we went on our 15-mile bike ride. On the way back from that bike ride, the doctor called. It was Saturday at 8 a.m. Never a good time. Ron had just had a physical. He was in great shape. But the doctor said, your lab tests have come back, and you're in a panic potassium level. And you need to get to the emergency room immediately. And Ron said, I just got off my bike. He said, get to the emergency room immediately. As I rushed him into the ER, they confirmed the test, and he wasn't at panic potassium level. And we had four doctors come in and all say the same thing. You should be dead. You should be dead. You should be dead. You should be dead. And then he coded. But they got him back. And they did more tests, and they found out he had renal cancer. Stage 4. No cure. So Ron had some choices to make, right? Dialysis, chemo, radiation, lots of choices. And he chose that, yes, he would choose dialysis because it would keep him alive and going. So 12 hours a week is all you know. He was hooked up to the machine, but he was still working away on his computer, and then he would get off his bike and get off the machine and get right on his bike. Doctors couldn't explain how somebody on dialysis was doing this. And Ron and I decided two things. Number one, we were going to support each other through the whole journey. And number two, we're going to bring as much joy to the situation as possible. So Ron had a great sense of humor. I mean, he was in and out of the hospital, fluid on the lungs, infections, and every time we pulled up to the emergency room, he would go, ah, my alma mater! Had us all laughing. Fast forward, it's the next May. May is my busiest month. Nurses Week, Hospital Week, healthcare conferences. I'm all over the place. And I had left Ron, and he was doing fine. We took a 15-mile bike ride 3 days before. But it was a Wednesday morning at 7 a.m. that his dialysis nurse said, Ron isn't here. He's never late. She says, I've got to go track him down. And she went well above her job description, and sure, she started calling his home, and then his cell phone, and then his daughter, and finally she got me in Miami at a hotel, and I was getting ready to go on a speak, and we got the police in, and the police got him to Mayo Clinic, and he was alive, although the cancer had hit the brain, and he had a stroke, and he had been on the floor, bathroom floor, for 2 days. So I got rushed back to Scottsdale as quick as I could and met with the oncologist. And the oncologist showed me the brain scan, and it was like the final gunshot wound to the head. I knew then that I had to do the hardest thing that I would ever have to do, and that is sign the papers to cut off dialysis and let Ron die. But all of a sudden, some of Ron's friends started coming in, and they said, Ron, you know, can we be there for your last dialysis treatment? Mayo ICU, can we bring our guitars and banjos? And I'm like, he said, I'm paralyzed on my left side, but my right arm, I'm going to be hooked up to the machine, but I think I can still play an air guitar. And I'm like, all right. So, another miracle. Just days ago, I found a 15-second clip of Ron's last dialysis treatment in Mayo ICU, and he's playing his air guitar. Can you run it, guys? There was more of her there. Wow. Wow, yeah. Wow. Unbelievable. Who celebrates like that, your last dialysis treatment? So after they had their jamming session, he was transferred to a hospice facility. And when he got there, I said, Ron, do you have any requests? And he says, yes, I would like an interactive funeral. I said, what? I want to be alive at my funeral. Okay, whatever. And within 24 hours, we had a live funeral. There was standing room only at the community room at the hospice center. We had people on conference calls all over the world. We had people on Skype who were dialing in and sending cards and messages to be read at the funeral. Ron and I got up in a wheelchair, and he had us laughing 1 minute and crying the next. He said, Kathy, I'm going to be traveling with you now, speaking. I'll just be outside the plane. What? So when he took Ron back to his hospice room, I said, sweetheart, how are you doing this? How are you dying so well? I mean, I've got my graduate degrees in death and dying. Teach me. He said, you die well by living well today. Wow. And then the phone rang, and it was the organ donation people. And we had already talked to him, and I said, listen, his whole body is ridden with cancer, but can't we just do an evaluation? And they said, we have. Ron can donate his skin. So I walk up to Ron, and I said, sweetheart, I know you're ready to go to bed, but they just called from the organ donation, you can donate your skin. And he said, I'm shedding my skin so that other people can live. Woo! You know, I went home that night to bed, and I think I realized for the first time how much this man loved me. And how much I loved him to the depths of my soul. So I woke up the next morning, I looked in the mirror, and I said, you're getting married today. It's like, what? Get your parents' rings out of the jewelry box and get on your bike and pedal 3 blocks to the hospice. So I'm pedaling away, and all of a sudden I'm thinking, we've never talked about the M word. That means I'm going to have to ask him. My throat started getting a little dry and stomach started churning, and I'm like, what if he says no? I mean, what if a dying man tells you no? I mean, that'll be 10 more years of therapy. But I knocked on the door and I said, sweetheart, I have a question for you. Will you marry me? He said, yes. Yes. So then there was a knock on the door. It was the hospital's chaplain. He said, can I help you? And I said, well, matter of fact, do you marry people? He said, yeah, I got the book in my car. I'll be right back. And then he came back and he performed the ceremony right by the bedside. And then he said, you know, will you tell Lizzie to go get that bottle of water from our first date 5 years ago? And I said, you kept a bottle of water from our first date? He said, yeah. And I said, well, I guess there are some things you shouldn't shed. He said, I want to toast our wedding. And so we toasted with the water. And I said, Ron, this has been an amazing 5 years. And he said, and the next five are going to be even more amazing. Wow. 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 So, you know, when the minister back at Mayo ICU got there, Reverend Miraj, they had become big buddies. And he walked in the room back at Mayo ICU. And the first thing, he looks up to Reverend Miraj, and he says, Reverend Miraj, I've got some bad news for you. Your guitar lesson is canceled this week. And then he said, does Jesus have a band? Because I want to be the lead guitarist, and I'm thinking I better start rehearsing because auditions are coming pretty soon. And just over and over again, this man died like I've never seen anybody. You know, I don't know about you, but I believe Ron's here today. I think he is. He's looking down from heaven, and first of all, he wants to say to you, thank you. Thank you. Thank you for what you do every day to go above and beyond, way beyond your job description, to care for these patients like they're part of your family, because if that one dialysis nurse had not made it her mission to find Ron and track him down, he would have never lived the most amazing last week of his life. So thank you. And Ron also wanted to say, well, this is the picture of the, I actually did get married after his funeral. I know that sounds a little strange, doesn't it? He was alive, though. He really was alive. Yes, yes, yes. Ron wanted me to say one more thing, and he wanted to say, we are stronger together. Amazing theme. And he said, you know, I'm also, tell the audience, thanks for making my name part of your theme. What are the 3-letter words? Ron? So Ron said one request as we close this session together, and that is I've got little lizards about this big that need adopting. So if you are an energizer, if you about first 20 people that hop up on the stage and everybody else, if you'll stand, I need 20 people to hop up on the stage if we'll stand as we close. All right, come on, guys. Run. Okay, all right. Stand in line. All right, stand in line. Okay. Okay. We're going to have some more lizards here. All right. Okay, all right. So here is our assignment, okay? All right, we are going to celebrate the shed, okay? We're going to celebrate the shed by having a shedibration, all right? So you guys are going to lead us, all right? And you all are going to see. You're going to recognize this song. We're just going to change the words, all right? So the first the first part of the chorus, we're gonna clap, all right? Then when we get to the reframe, then we're all gonna do the wave. And the challenge is, can 4,000 people do the wave in sync, all right? Hit the music, guys! All right!
It's a celebration.
Celebrate good time, come on!
Let's celebrate, come on now.
We're gonna do the wave now. We're gonna have a refresh. Wow!
Great.
It's all right. Again, we're gonna have a refresh sight. Let's celebrate. It's all right. Again, we're gonna have a refresh sight. Let's celebrate. It's all right. One more time. We're gonna have a refresh sight. Let's celebrate. It's all right. Woo! Times, come on! Let's go! Woo! Woo! Wow! You just set a record. I want to see the footage. You would not believe what you all did. And you hadn't even practiced it. Wow, all right. So if you all will see me, I will be at lunchtime. You come adopt your lizard. You come see me, tell me one thing you're gonna shed. I'll give you some bracelets. If you want an I'm allergic to negativity bracelet, and we've got all kinds of downloads. We'll send you links to all the things you wanna use and you can take back and help other people shed. Yeah, yes. Oh, bless you, bless you, bless you. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Bless you. And I'll see you around lunchtime, guys. Thanks.
Kathy. Oh.